good?
Everything's fine.
Okay. All right, well, welcome. My name's Ryan. I'm here with the museum. And before we get started with our program, there's a few words that we always like to say, the first of which is thank you for coming out. I know, a little blustery Tuesday evening, but thanks for braving the elements to come see us. Unfortunately, he's probably not going to get any better. So thanks for coming out tonight. Words of thanks that we want to say. The first one goes to Rodrigo for speaking with us tonight, and he'll be showing us a lot of really great images and talking about some of his techniques, and I'm sure a lot of other stuff that hopefully will help anybody if you're interested in trying to do something like this. He probably has some words of wisdom for you, I'm sure. And also just a chance to kind of see some of these images that are out in the universe that most of us don't really get a chance to see on a daily basis. So looking forward to that. So thanks to Rodrigo. And then also I want to say thanks to the Neville Public Museum's Astronomical Society. The reason that we're doing this program tonight is partly that we've got a really great exhibit upstairs right now called Eyes on the Sky. It's pretty much all artifacts that club members have lent to us and allowed us to put on display and have worked with us, giving us the information and the content about those artifacts. And what we're trying to do in that exhibit is tell the story of what you can observe from this particular place in the universe. So using different telescopes, there's quite a few historical telescopes on display. There's quite a bit of artwork, which I would consider this photography a big part of that, and a number of other things that are pretty interesting. So if you've not got a chance to see that exhibit yet, it is up through the end of the month. I forget the exact closing day. I believe it's the last weekend in October. November 6th, right? So it goes just a few more weeks. So if you hadn't had a chance yet, please do come back, check it out. A great time to do that is the first Wednesday evening of every month. It's our free night for Brown County residents. So from 5 until 8, that first Wednesday every month is free for Brown County residents. You just have to give them your zip code when you come in, and they'll wave you on through. So that's a great time to see that. And also our Ice Age Imperials exhibit is also coming down soon. That one I think might be coming a little bit sooner. So if you want to see that, you'll have to come in probably a little bit before that free night. Other events that we have going on that might be of interest, this Friday we're actually doing a public star party, so we'll be outside just in the front here. I'm not sure how many folks will be there with telescopes, but there'll probably be quite a handful all aimed at different objects in the sky. You can come on over, it's pretty casual, it's drop-in. Find a telescope that looks interesting, take a peek through, and the club members who are here to help us will tell you what you're looking at and how you're looking at it and give you some great information. And then a couple other programs we have coming up. Next Wednesday, we're having a Halloween-themed program called Morbid Curiosities. And in that program, what we're going to be doing is talking about some of the darker objects and darker stories in the museum's collection. We're going to be pulling out some artifacts from storage that aren't normally on display, so it's kind of a one-night-only thing. We'll be putting those up throughout the galleries, and then we'll be looking at some of the objects that are up in the galleries currently on display. So hopefully taking kind of a different look at the exhibits that you may not have seen if you've come through before, and seeing some things that are kind of an exclusive chance to see, telling some stories. And this should be a pretty interesting program. So there's information about all these upcoming programs on our website as well, and also some registration information. And the last one I'll mention, typically we do these talks like we're seeing tonight on the second Tuesday of the month, but next month I hear there's something going on the second Tuesday, so we moved it back to the first Tuesday. We're going to be having a talk about the history of the bicycle boom in Wisconsin. So that's going to be the first Tuesday, I believe it's November 1st. I'd have to double check on that. Last word of thanks I want to say is to our Neville Public Museum Foundation. They're the folks who raise all the money to help us build exhibits like Eyes in the Sky and bring in traveling exhibits like the Ice Age Imperials and the Fort Howard, Life and Death at Fort Howard. They helped us build all throughout the year. We have all these temporary exhibits that are coming and going, and they also fund the programs that go along with them like this. So really we're here tonight because they were able to raise money and help fund that cause. And you too can be a member of that society. With the membership, there's a number of different rates, but pretty reasonable considering the benefits you'll get. I think there's over 500 or 600 museums worldwide that you get free admission to with your membership. That's probably the biggest one, but also other great benefits like free membership to this museum and many of our programs, discounts on programs, even if there is a fee, and of course 10% off in the gift shop, which is the most important one. So that's my sales pitch to you. If you want some more information about it, you can ask our staff at the front desk. They'll give you some information and they can help you get signed up, tell you about the different rates and all the benefits. So I'll leave it there and turn it over to our speaker tonight. So please join me in welcoming Rodrigo.
Thank you, Ryan. So the first disclosure, I'm not professional in that area. It's just for fun. In astronomy, you can choose whatever area you like. It's a nice thing of a hobby. That is, you don't have to go, if you are a professional, suppose in astronomy, you really need to be good in most of the areas. And when you are amateur, you just choose whatever you like the most, and you do it. So just my talk is going to be divided in two portions. The first part is an introduction of what is DSLR astrophotography, or what is DSLR, or what cameras I use to do that. And the second portion is a series of pictures I have taken over the years. And also, maybe in some of them, I will just talk a little bit more what I actually took a picture of. But please feel free to just ask questions in the middle of the talk. So, because some areas, maybe if you're not very familiar, may be a little bit confusing for you, and you may want more explanation, otherwise you may get lost in later on. So, starting with the DSLR, if you see these terms, if you take the D away, then you see SLR. In the old times of film, just single lens reflex. And of course, you add the D and now it's digital. So that actually made it a little bit more easier to use this type of, I would say, mass-produced equipment to for astrophotography. That in the past was much more difficult, and the film, it wasn't sensitive enough, so you have to apply several techniques. Even taking regular pictures wasn't that easy because you couldn't see them, and sometimes you didn't know how the picture was going to look like at the end until they developed the film. So, let's see. Okay. So I will have some pictures. So you will see here a series of pictures, some of them pictures I include within the talk, so it doesn't become too boring sometimes. This is too many technical sentence or information. I don't know you. We were living in this pretty north, so I hope that you have seen the northern lights sometime. If you haven't, once in a while there is some website that you can check, and it's a really nice experience. You just have to look for a very dark place. This picture was taken from Kiwani. We have an observatory in that area, and it's fairly dark, and you just look at the south and the north, sorry, and you'll see very nice this place. So starting with the basics. So what is the heart of a camera is the sensor. So what is important is that compared with the film, actually sensors are more sensitive because they actually can capture more of the light. So the camera looks like your eye. It's just looking at the light that is coming. It's not how much you can see, how much light you can collect. So what it's doing in this case is convert all the optical image into electric signal. And then start processing there. The cameras will have a processor and start doing a series of, like a computer, you put it this way. And you start forming the image starting from the conversion of this electric signal. So as mentioned before, it's much more sensitive than film, so that helps to have much more shorter exposures. One thing that we also have to take into account, that when we see something, we point it to a star, it won't be capturing everything, it will be capturing a portion. And there is another term in here that looks a little bit hard to understand, just quantum efficiency, but it's And the reason why I'm just giving this, because when you go to the market, even if you buy a regular camera, you kind of will see these sensors and you'll try to understand what actually you are buying. It's better to have a little bit more of, or to understand a little bit more of the concept. So this, what it means, quantum efficiency, the capacity of the material of the sensor is made of to actually capture this light. So when we think about DSLR, sometimes people refer these DSLRs to the old film and they say, oh, what ISO you are using. It's not really the same, because ISO in the old times, well, the film was, they have different sensitivity because it was made of an emulsion. And in this case, all the cameras have only one sensitivity. What is happening is inside is like a computer taking this electric signal, is amplifying the signal, and that's why you have this name of ISO. But you need to have something to collect that, that is the sensor. And the sensor is how good it is, or how sensitive is the sensor for the light, is what is most important. Now, another term that you will see very is in all the cameras is the CMOS. And I will show some pictures later on about this, basically made of pixels. So I think this is a very common term that you see, oh, 16 megapixels or 20 megapixels, and sometimes you think, oh, more of is more, much is better. We will see that maybe it's not the case all the time. And also another important term is you have every pixel is going to capture these electrons, or these photons, I will say, and this convert into electrons, and depends how many every pixel captures is the amount of information, and it's called dynamic range. You will see many more, even in TVs you see it, they put a lot of pixels in there, and you see that every single one has many more options or grade, supposing in gray or shadows or things that you can see a little bit more details. So sometimes you see just black or white, but it's really not black and white. There is a lot of shades within that. If this is not good, if you have a very low dynamic range, you just see one particular intensity, but then you don't see so many details. So I was talking about what is CMOS, so it means complementary metal oxide semiconductor. So this, basically, you open your camera, you will see that is something like that. Of course, you won't see the colors. This is under the microscope that you will see the colors, so you just see like, look like a brown. So it's basically, each one of these will represent an individual pixel. So all the cameras, even though take pictures in colors, the cameras are not real, they are not in colors. It's a filter that they put over this sensor. So in general, at the beginning, so all the cameras are born black and white, and then they make them color. And with all this information, you will understand why now this is important when you want to choose a camera. And when you think about, oh, my camera can take pictures black and white. Basically, cameras can take pictures black and white. What they do is you take the pictures in color and then eliminate the color later on. So this kind of filter is actually glued to the sensor. So the sensor is seeing different colors. But if you will be able to remove that, then it will be black and white. But in factory, they actually put these filters. So another interesting thing is when you see the filter, they actually have blue, green, and red. And they combine all these three colors to form all the colors that we know. So, and of course, what is doing it is the light pass through this. So each color has an electron that is assigned to that, and this combination just tells the color where it is. The camera will do it inside. When you also buy a camera, you will see a small stickers where say, oh, this is type of a processor that they have. So it's just basically a small computer that is designed to do one thing, that is process the photons that come from the light into electric signal and interpret this into an image and build it again. Kind of what our brain would do. Okay. So another big question, and this is very interesting, is the sensor size. And some instance bigger is better, and this is one of the times where bigger is better. And with the modern cameras, you see that it's a competition. Even phones will say, oh, this has 8 megapixels, this has 20 megapixels, so it must be better. But not necessarily, because that doesn't mean better resolution. So there are two type of resolution that you will see. One type of resolution is spatial resolution. So that means that you can take a picture and you can make a huge, huge picture, 40 inches, even a mirror if you want, if you have a lot of pixels in there. However, it doesn't mean that you will see a lot of details in there. And the other one is you will be able to see a lot of details because each pixel will be able to capture a lot of information. As we saw before, we have a much more higher dynamic range because the pixels are much bigger, but not too many. But they will be able to capture that. So how do you do that? The sensor size. So suppose this, they call the famous point and shoot cameras, everything is automatic. The cameras are small, or your phone, they have a very, very, very small, tiny sensor in there. And they just partition the sensor in small pieces, and the problem is each small pixel is so small that they won't be able to capture that much light. So you don't capture that many details. There are a lot of other technologies to help to get much more light, because as we saw before, not all the light is captured. They put micro lenses or do other things in there to improve that, and that way you have seen much better resolutions. However, it's not as good as having a big sensor, and this is the reason why you see the DSLR cameras, where you can, they have much more bigger sensor and have much, much better resolution. They take better pictures. So another important thing is what is called noise, because all the electronics produce noise. What it means is this noise is like small dots that are forming there. So they usually are overpowered by the light that comes. But when you take pictures in places where there is not too much light, then you see this noise. So you see all these pictures in the dark areas, you see a bunch of small dots. And it could be, there are two types of noise. The one is because of the heating that you see colors, and the other one is kind of white and grainy. Resemble the old times of film when you use higher ISOs, and this kind of what the noise looks like. So how do you, the problem with that is you lose your very fine details. How do you compensate for that? Taking much more longer exposure to capture much more light, so they overpower the noise produced by the electronics. So I was talking about what the size matters, and it's just an example. So you have the same camera sensor, and one is 8 megapixels, suppose, the other one is 16 megapixels. So what is going to, or maybe 20, what is going to happen then is the 8 megapixels is going to be like that, and the small one. So you see in one unit of time, suppose 1 minute, how much photons, in this case, the analogy will be the water droplets, how much will you capture in 1 minute versus this. So if you think that this is light, you get much more information here that will be getting in here. So what is what I mean with that. So, and this one, this is light, is just kind of emphasizing what I was just talking about. So at this point, anybody has a question, and everybody's following me with that, or I lost you already. Just please just ask questions. And this is another example of what I was talking about, what is noise. So if you take this 9 water droplets or noise, then you get 3, because every time that you keep the camera open, is the electronics are producing, and then it's about 3, but once you start exposure more, this kind of remains slower. So at this point, you see that now you have much more signal, and your picture looks better, and you expose even more because you capture many more photons. Your picture is more, can many more details. So this is what just means that. So That's why now if you go out and buy a camera, you realize that, okay, why I want the camera for? If you just want to take picture of portraits with plenty of sunshine, a small one is good. If I want to go out and start taking pictures places, even in a party, even a place that is really dark, or maybe it's better if I want to go into a camera that is at least a DSLR, or the new ones that they don't have the L anymore because they don't have a reflex lens. It's called the mirrorless cameras. They still have a fairly big sensor that you can, that can give you much more better resolutions. Okay, so we're just starting. I'm gonna start mixing a little bit more. Not too far. One of the things that you can do with DSLR is, if you have a one that captures enough light, you can expose to get aurora light. If you haven't seen, usually most of the aurora is look green, and sometimes you start seeing a little bit more colors, but you don't see it as colorful as you can see in this picture. And the reason why is because the eyes don't have that much capability or capacity to capture colors. However, the camera does, and the sensor that you saw can do it. So now, one of the beauties of using just regular cameras is that you can take this type of pictures. You just need a tripod and set your camera and be in the, at the, in the right place at the right time, of course. So, something happened here. I think it started. Okay. So with the DSLR camera, that's very, very flexible. So why? Because unlike the other camera that you can buy that are mostly automatic, you have creative controls. When I say creative controls, you can have the aperture. That is means how much you can open the small window that is inside of the camera to allow the light to go through. That also is depends on the lens that you are using. As I discussed before, we have the sensors are much bigger, and also you can change your lenses. And depends which camera, some lenses are can adapt to the type of picture that you would like to take. You wanna go take sceneries, or you wanna take nightscapes, or just portraits, or sports. So you can do so many things with the DSLR camera. That's why is so so flexible. However, of course, it doesn't fit in your pocket. And one thing that I do with that is you can hook it directly to your telescope and use your telescope as a instead of a lens and start taking pictures of the sky. Could be planets or the deep sky that are, as I'm gonna show in the next slides. So, just talking about best application for astrophotography. You can do picture of the moon. So nightscapes, they're beautiful nightscapes that you can see on the internet. Sometimes people travel to the national parks, the Grand Canyon, Monument Valley, Yosemite, or all these, and they just picture, take an amazing picture of the Milky Way in the background. And you don't need just a tripod, the camera, and of course a camera that is sensitive enough that you don't need to expose that long to capture enough information and capture the sceneries. But a lot of other things that you do, like auroras, as you saw in the previous picture, you can take amazing rainbows. Moonbows, so it's a rainbow that produces instead of with the sun, it's the moonlight that produces that. Sun dogs, sunsets. So anything and you know, everything that you can take within 30 seconds, and the modern cameras are actually in 30 seconds, sometimes it's actually plenty. You can do planetary and moon photography, where you can actually do connect this directly to the telescope and do quick shots of some of the planets. You can see at least a lot of features in the moon, for example. And something that I have done a lot, and this deep sky astrophotography. That is basically a little bit more complicated because it's not only connecting the camera and the telescope, but you have to start doing things to the camera, modify it, and attach to a telescope that actually can track because the exposure times become very long. instead of being 30 seconds, you can talk about 15 minutes exposures or more sometimes. So what's an example of what would be a wide field picture taken with just camera lens is these two nebulas. It's called the Heart and Soul Nebula, and that is in the Perseus constellation and is a double cluster. If you go sometimes to a dark place and you go to look at the north, there is a part with Perseus and Cassiopeia, and there is, if it's a very dark place, you can see kind of a fuzzy part. That is a cluster of stars. It's an upper cluster, that means that a lot of stars are close together but not too close, and they are made of very, very new stars. The colors actually showing you, blue stars are more young stars. And these nebulas, the shape is produced for stellar winds, and they produce this nice shape. So what happened in these nebulas is a nursery where the stars actually are born. They're made of mostly hydrogen, and other forces start occurring in there. So the stars, hydrogen star, start interacting, the atoms of hydrogen start interacting up to the point that they start forming stars. So this is just one example of what you could do, something that you couldn't see on naked eye, you couldn't see these nebulas, but the DSLR camera will have enough capability to do that. In this image, actually, I used a regular camera lens, and it was a 100 millimeter camera lens. The only thing is the camera was mounted in a equatorial mount that had the capabilities of keep tracking. So it means they keep the same rotation as the Earth is rotating, so the stars don't trail, because the exposure were about 5 minutes. So there are things that you can do to improve your camera. A lot of people do the sensors in general do modifications, but the sensor in general has very stock filters, as we saw these color filters. What it does is limit, they want to mimic what the human eye will see, because it's just for regular photography. However, they have parts in the spectra that reject that light that actually use very useful for astrophotography. So now what they are doing, a lot of people do, I have done that too, is basically perform some surgery in the camera, or there are other people that can do that for you. You are not very inclined on this kind of activities. Then what they do is remove the stock filter from the sensor and put another one that actually is not going to mimic what the human eye is going to see. It's going to be a little bit, it's going to let more light to pass through. So the sensor is going to collect light that otherwise will be rejected. It's like having, an example, like you see light through a grid. If you have very, very fine a grid, you don't see that much light, but if you start making the grid a little bit wider, you will see more light. It's kind of the same analogy, but in this case, it will be the type of light. When we see it, is divided in wavelengths, and some of them will be rejected because the filter will will be very narrow enough that will just reject this light coming, so the sensor never will see it. So there is a lot of modification that can be done. And it's the first one is just remove this filter and put another one that will let more light to go through. There are other ones where they totally remove the filter and the camera will actually have full spectrum, where you will see the sensor will see any wavelength. There are downsides on that, and one of them is the camera lenses may not work very well for regular photography. And the reason why they use that filter is not only to mimic what the human eye will see, but to improve the quality of the focusing. Since some of the wavelengths like ultraviolet and infrared don't focus in the same plane that the regular, the other colors do. So you will get a little bit more fuzzy images if you do that and use the camera for regular photography. So I'm just talking about a little bit more about equipment. So we can use to take pictures of auroras or any other phenomena or that you would like. No, you don't have to modify your camera. Or you can use the regular picture. There is always something that you can do with even any regular camera if you actually carry it, and sometimes you see nice sunsets, even that. So you can do a lot of things if you don't modify it, but you are still limited. So now there is a different type of lens that you can use, and one of the things that you will notice in photography is a number that is called F. So to make it simple is how much the lens will open to let more light to go through, but also is inversely proportional, the number is inversely proportional to the aperture. That means that lower the number, a wider the lens opens. But these lenses, wider the lens open also tends to be a little bit more pricey because it costs much more money for the opticians to actually make or correct the lens well enough that will capture the image without distortion at the corners. When you are thinking, okay, why I need this kind of aperture? Because more light you let pass through, your exposure is going to be shorter. And you are trying to look for a shorter exposure but capture still enough light. So you have two options. You wait for the light, much more light, like wait for your bucket that you saw before to fill up with drops of light, if you want to call. Or the other option is having a wider bucket. So that is what also with the analogy in the lens. The focal distance, you hear, okay, I use 100 millimeters, 14 millimeters. So what it means is shorter means you see more, so it's wider, but it's less magnification. So that is mostly what is called wide field, and is when you can capture mostly auroras or the Milky Way, for example. You go something in the middle, just to give you an example, about 100 millimeters, 110 millimeters through a camera is what your actually eyes will see, kind of would be the equivalent because sometimes you take a picture like, oh, this looks closer where I saw it, or much more farther away the way that I saw it. So just to mimic a little bit what the distance you will see it in just the regular eyes would be about 110 millimeters. And of course, you can go to the zoom lenses or the telephoto lenses that could go from 100 to 400, and you can use it to take pictures of the galaxies, to take pictures of a small group of stars, and of course, nice sunset coming out of some place where you have moonrise or moonset too, where you see the big sun or the big moon coming from one portion of the sky. It's just very, very big. So this is when the people use this type of focal length. And of course, if you are gonna do pictures at night, the first thing you need is a camera tripod. And there are other ways to do it. It's called a bandor tracker. It's a very cheap device that will help you to follow the Earth rotation. So you will be able to take pictures of Milky Way, at least, constellations and things like that. And you will, when I say be able, because you will get, if you don't use that, your stars are going to trail. They're going to look like small comets, and eventually will be lines, depending on how long you're exposed. So just this really quick, I mentioned who can do that if you cannot modify your camera to make more sensitive. And there is different website, different person that do that, and they charge you different amount according to the camera. And newer the camera, sometimes more expensive because they say that it's more difficult to do the modification. And then there is a lot of brands of the mount that could track the Earth rotation, so you get longer exposures and you can see much sharper objects and take pictures of some of the deep sky that I call deep sky when I say galaxies, or things that you can't use, things that you can see with your naked eye. There are wide variety of telescopes, so they are reflectors is when they have lenses, reflectors is when they have mirrors, or a combination of them that you can choose. So there are so many things that of course we could talk forever about that, it's just to give you an example. And there are other things, because they taking long exposure picture of the deep sky after a while becomes a little bit more complex, because then you need other equipment to even improve the quality of your pictures. And it's what is called guider. What it does is all these mounts, as you can see here, they are mechanic. The mechanic gears are not perfect, so you need something to compensate for that. And when you expose for very long time, all this imperfection will show in your image as it starts elongated or egg shape or so on, and you need other ways to compensate. So it's just a guide. It's just to, at least just want to give you an information that these kind of things exist, or why you see suddenly you see beautiful pictures out there, like, oh, how they have done that. And it's a lot of components involved in taking just an image. That looks scary at the beginning, and it's a really very, very steep learning curve, but when everything works and you see your image, then it's a lot of reward too. Yes. So this is another, not too long ago, and like a month ago, that picture is part of the previous one. So I took the previous one and this one, that actually was from up north. So in the background, where you see the Milky Way and just the auroras. So now that you are more familiar with the lenses, I used a 14 millimeter lens to be able to take this. So you can see a piece, a little bit portion of the trees in here. So it's a very, very wide field. So really quick, so there are different ways to do it, to prepare your picture. The first thing is how you're gonna focus this. You connect this to the telescope or the camera lens. Reason why it looks complicated is because at night, you won't be able to do the same focusing that you can do with during the day, and the cameras may not be able to do it easier. So there are different ways to do it, different software that will help you. Some of the software is free, and some of the software you have to pay for it. And one thing that's important is if you are in the middle of nowhere, some of this equipment needs power, and it's something that you need to think about, sometimes batteries or adapters or things like that. Then the second question is, what I do, some of this is not only having the mount and the camera, you have to connect now the camera to a computer to see what you are doing. So it's start becoming a little bit more complicated. So when you are doing this type of photography, there also you need a laptop to have in the field. Sometimes you can, there are certain devices, they call standalone devices, that will do it for you, but sometimes they're not work as good. So there is a different software that actually will help you to do that. Again, some of this software is free and comes even with the camera like this one. And some of this software you pay a little bit, and some of this software you can pay much more. So one thing that is interesting, I just forgot to mention here. It's not gonna. What's in there is called the time lapse, that you can buy in your regular camera with the tripod. You can buy a small device, costs about $40, you connect and you can program and tell the camera how many exposures you want to take, how long in between exposure and how long the exposure. So you can then, there are a lot of free software, you can take all these pictures, put it together and just create a beautiful movie of what is happening during the day. Or you can also, I'm going to show you some pictures called star trails. So now the exposure at night is a little bit more difficult. So how are you gonna see how long you can expose? And they have a lot of aid in there. What is happening is there is what is called a histogram. When you take a picture, the camera is gonna, and this is any picture, any camera, DSLR camera, you take a picture in the back, it's gonna show a histogram that you can see in the menu part of the camera. And the only thing that you have to see is it's a small graph, and this graph, I may go here, and it's what you see. You will see in the back of your camera, and the only thing that you have to make sure, and this is separate from this area, and then you will know that your exposure is good enough. So it's just a quick way to know if what you are doing actually is right. So as we did, the other problems that come with that is temperature, and I'm not gonna go through all of this. It's just it's just an overview. If you have more questions, we can talk later on, or you can email me. So one of the things is, again, what I mentioned is just exposure time. You're exposed just to have this histogram separate from the left side. And I talked about the ISO before, and it's basically most of the cameras, and when you use the DSLR, depending on what you are doing, you should go during the day. I guess it would be lower, but if you go during the night, of course, you want to shorten your exposure time. The best thing to do is go to higher ISO, but not too high. So modern cameras and some of the most expensive top-of-the-line cameras let you go much more higher because they have a very big sensor and they will capture a lot of light. So what it's doing, as I mentioned before, is just taking all this light, and they have this amplifier, and you have one photon, it's just going to copy this one in two or three or X amount. But if you capture noise instead of light, then you will see all this noise too. So depends on the type of the camera is the versatility of ISO. Even though some of these cameras will tell you, you can go to 1,200, 20,000. There are some of them 120,000. But the type of picture that you will get is not good. Most of them is just commercial or advertisement. So people think that they are very good and they just buy in this way. But what you need to do in astrophotography, at least, is just expose enough that you will get this histogram separate, and you can increase the ISO until certain extent. Usually what I do is, because this camera heats up, and the camera heats up over time, during summer I go low, around 800, during winter I can do 1600. So there are other things that can do. So now they are going to a little bit more. This is image that I took last year. I haven't finished the image because I'm going to add the color portion. Sometimes I have other cameras that have been further modified to remove the color filter that is on top of that. And you can take basically just one particular wavelength. I use a special filter. It's called a hydrogen filter. And only let one particular wavelength, that is the hydrogen, and this nebula is called the cone nebula. It's called the cone nebula, and it's rich in hydrogen, another region where the stars are born. And if you see certain areas are black in here, it's just because there is interstellar dust that actually blocks the light from the nebula to come to our, so we can see it. So that is when I add the color portion, then I'm gonna combine these two. There is ways to do it, and then you're gonna see a lot of colors. Usually these stars reflect, and some of them are blue, and other ones are red, because mostly this color, the hydrogen is shown as red. But there is many other things that you can see, and there is a small nebula here. They call the Hubble Variable Nebula. If you see it in the telescope, it's like looking at a comet. And you can fool somebody, actually have done that. Oh, look at the comet, and people get really happy, and then realize that it's just a nebula, it's not a comet, but it looks like a comet. So it's all kind of things that I have done. This was done with a small telescope. This thing not working. Okay. So I'm just gonna mention this really quick. One way to actually improve your picture is when you take a picture, suppose you take a picture of 5 minutes, You also can cover your camera lens and take a picture in the dark. And so what it's gonna do is, it's called a dark frame, and it's just gonna remove all the noise that was part of the noise that was produced by the exposure, so it will help you to clean your picture. It's part of the process in astrophotography, is very, very common. And the only way that this has been decreased is when the new modern cameras that are not real DSLR, they actually cool down the sensor. They have cooling devices that cool the camera up to minus 30 degrees or minus 40 degrees, so there is much less noise produced on this. So now you don't need dark frames, you don't need that. So it's called just dark frames, and if you will read a little bit more of astrophotography, you will see really this term everywhere. and it's just covering the camera or the telescope and taking exactly the same exposure you did with your light at the same temperature, and you have software that will take this noise and subtract one noise from the other. And this is just an example of what I was talking about. So you will see all these things that are collecting the noise from the electronics, or sometimes the glow because the electronics are heating up the sensor. This doesn't happen that much in the modern cameras, but it used to be. And then you just take the same sensor and is when I subtract that, and you will get much more cleaner picture. And again, you will hear banding and bias frames. It's exactly the same thing, but it just produces for the conversion of the photons into electric noise. They produce some type of electric signal, They produce some called banding, and that way you do the same thing. Kind of similar to dark frame, it's just a picture that's taken with the camera without the lens or cover, and you just take it really, really quick, the maximum the camera would be able to take a picture. And you load all this picture into a software that is actually free. Some of them you pay, but they're very efficient software that is free. And you get a much more cleaner picture. So what I'm showing with this is, even with low price camera, you don't have to break the bank to be able to start doing astrophotography. You can do the basics and enjoy it. And of course, it's like a black hole. They say your money goes there, and you can always spend more money in all these things, and you can keep spending, and every time there is something new. But the question is, just do it as much as you can, do what you can afford and enjoy at the same time. And the last one is the flat frames, and it's mostly because when you take the lenses of the camera, you get dust particles and things like that, and what it does is just record that what is in there that shouldn't be part of the picture, and again the software just will remove that, as you can see there. And it's very common in the DSLR cameras. Every time that you remove that, things go in there. And now the new ones actually, you have some grids that make the sensor vibrates and dust the sensor, so it's not as bad as the old cameras, but it still happens. And once in a while, if it gets really bad, and one of the errors is switching your lenses in a place that is very windy and dusty. So it's better if you are traveling, at least bring a plastic bag.